Good evening, everyone. Hello, hello. My name's Lauren. I'm with the Brooklyn Museum and Adult Programs, part of our education division. So welcome to Target First Saturday. By a show of hands, can I just see how many of you guys have been to First Saturdays before? Excellent. Okay, perfect. So you know the drill. This is our night of free public programs. And this month, we're celebrating the special exhibition Agitprop, which is on view on the fourth floor. And we're really excited because we have a lot of fabulous artists whose work is actually on view in the show. So after the talk, please do go up to the fourth floor and check out the work that's on view. And stick around the rest of the night. We have programming until 10 p.m., so we hope you'll join us. So without further ado, I'm really excited to introduce a great friend of the museum's from Visual Aids, Alex Fiallo. He is the programs manager there, and he'll be introducing our panelists for the night. So please join me in welcoming Alex.
Hello and welcome. I'm Alex Fiallo. I'm the programs manager of Visual Aids, and thank you all for joining us tonight. It's really exciting to see such a full audience. I could not be more thrilled to introduce tonight's program, Women, Art, AIDS, and Activism, Here Then, Here Now. As many of you know, Visual Aids promotes HIV awareness through the visual arts, preserving the cultural contributions of those lost to AIDS, and supporting HIV-positive artists, because AIDS is not over. We do so through public programs like this, as well as exhibitions, publications, screenings, artist projects, and more. Tonight, we have a powerhouse lineup of artist activists here to discuss both their art and their role in HIV/AIDS activism. I want to thank our panelists for their participation tonight, as well as their ongoing commitment to HIV/AIDS activism. Joy Episalla, Egyptt Labeija, Kia Labeija, Carrie Moyer, LJ Roberts, Sue Schaffner, and Jessica Whitbread will all be here tonight sharing their work and their art, and their bios can be found in tonight's programs. We're also here to highlight and contextualize Visual Aid's latest series of placemark cards, which premiere in the Agitprop exhibition upstairs. The images are here on the right. Placemark trading cards are an honest and straightforward approach to promote harm reduction, HIV testing, pre- and post-exposure prophylaxis, and raise awareness around HIV/AIDS. Placemark features fun, sexy, and creative trading cards packaged with condoms and lube. The back of each trading card features information to help you play smart. We're thrilled that this year's set centers on women and HIV awareness, and we owe a tremendous thank you to LJ Roberts for approaching us with the idea to make this idea a reality, and for the Brooklyn Museum curatorial team, particularly Catherine Morris, Jess Wilcox, Saisha Grayson, and Stephanie Weisberg for working with us to show the placemark cards and premiere them in the exhibition. All three of the packs are available at the front, at the table at the front, so be sure to take some. We'd love if there were none left and you all had them and they lived in the world. We collaborated with an amazing group of women on this project. Tania Anderson, Beverly Bland Boydston III, Jean Foost, Raina Gossett, Kia Labeija, Alice O'Malley, Elizabeth Marie Rivera, Morgan Page, Jamie Q, LJ Roberts, Sue Schaffner, Serenia Siraskal, and Jessica Whitbread. It's really exciting to me to read that list of names and know how many perspectives went into making these cards possible, and with a really fantastic outcome. Finally, I want to thank the Brooklyn Museum First Saturdays team, especially Lauren Zelaya, for our ongoing collaboration. The Brooklyn Museum feels like home thus far. They let us hang up all of Jessica's banners this afternoon, which is really exciting for us, and you'll hear more about that from Jessica herself. And I want to thank my Visual Aids colleagues, Nelson Santos and Esther McGowan, for all the important work that they do to make programs like this possible. So without further ado, I will turn it over to our fantastic, brilliant, inspiring participants who will come out now. Joy Episalla, Egyptt Labeija, Kia Labeija, Carrie Moyer, LJ Roberts, Sue Schaffner, and Jessica Whitbread. Please welcome them to the stage.
Thank you all for coming to Women, Art, AIDS, and Activism, Here Then, Here Now. I'm so thrilled to present to you a group of artists and activists doing groundbreaking work. Their practices are diverse and dynamic, and I'm thrilled to have them here and to call them collaborators. Thank you to the Brooklyn Museum and the Sackler Center for Feminist Art for hosting this program and for their steadfast support of this project. And thank you to Visual Aids for continuously working to support art, AIDS, activism, discourse, and fun happen in New York City. A special thanks to Alex Fiallo. You're the best teammate I could ever ask for. I wanted to give you some background on how the special edition of Placemar came to fruition. It was a very deliberate process filled with collaboration. The project features women of trans, cis, and gender non-conforming experience that bring with them multiple and changing identities. The project, featuring 11 collaborators, is also very intergenerational. The eldest participant was born in 1953, and the oldest and the youngest in 1990, with ages in between. Dyke Action Machine, who are Carrie and Sue sitting here. A collective in the first wave of the exhibition of Agitprop, which you can view upstairs in the Sackler, nominated me to exhibit my work in the second wave. This is a huge privilege, and I'm so happy to be included in institutions. It also felt critically important to bring other people in. Museums are typically a place of very disproportionate demographics. When thinking about who and what I wanted to put forth in the third wave, I had a few ideas, but ultimately wanted to have an artist or collective that continued Carrie and Sue's amazing legacy of political feminist art that appeared both in and out of institutions. Visual AIDS is doing provocative and critical work in New York City and beyond to foster a large amount of panels, exhibitions, and events that open dialogues about the ongoing AIDS epidemic and to support artists living with HIV and preserve the legacies of those who have passed away. I have deep respect for the work they do, the community they create, and the conversations they enable. I wanted to bring them into Agitprop. An ongoing project of Visual AIDS has been their PlaySmart series, small packets that contain condoms, lube, and different cards that are given away at Visual AIDS events and spaces throughout the city. You probably saw them up front. The cards have a pinup on one side and facts or information, usually about prevention and testing on the other. Visual AIDS have produced 5 editions of PlaySmart so far. But I've wanted to see a PlaySmart that centered women for a really long time. Too often, women and trans and gender non-conforming people and their health concerns are sidelined when it comes to the ongoing AIDS epidemic, and pretty much everywhere else, if we're gonna be real about women's health. Like, let me tell you how hard it is to get an appointment at Beth Israel, where there's like an amazing trans provider that you feel comfortable with, who's a kick-ass and wonderful, but it takes a while to get that appointment. Agitprop provided an opportunity to create a project that would be part of the exhibition, but also circulates knowledge, art, and activism through the world. It has safer sex tools. This version had an internal condom, an external condom, and lube. And so the internal condom is a new addition. And circles back to collectives like Dyke Action Machine, who plastered their art in the street as an act of political visibility in the 1990s. Furthermore, the project presented the opportunity to assemble an exceptional group of artist collaborators who impact their community and beyond. The artists and activist collaborators featured on the cards are Beverly Bland Boydston III, Kia Labeija, Raina Gossett, Serena Sirisical, and Jessica Whitbread. Artist collaborators Alice O'Malley and Sue Schaffner and Jamie Q provided some of the photography. Additionally, the artworks of Kia and Jessica are featured on 4 of the 9 cards. And Kia's work is on the brochure for tonight. Beautiful. These women are a very fierce and badass group, and each of every one of them is an artist and activist, though their work and areas of focus are powerfully and wonderfully different. All of them bring multiple and intersectional identities into their work, and it felt important to have images of women on the cards, as previously PlaySmart's packets featured pinups of men. Interestingly, the project features 5 images of women, trans, cis, and gender nonconforming, and this echoes the poster upstairs of Carrie and Sue's on the Action Machine. Total coincidence, but probably not at the same time. The information on the back of the cards addresses prevention and testing information, specifically for women of trans experience, and the connections between reproductive justice and HIV/AIDS. The packets celebrate desire and are resolutely sex positive. We worked with Elizabeth Marie Rivera, who did the graphic design for the cards, and Jean Foose, who designed the poster displayed in the exhibition. Collaborators also included Morgan Page and Tanya Anderson. Part of the motivation for the project was to get as many women into the museum as I could and to get them all paid. Yeah. Artists should be paid, and I wanted to throw off the disparities of who gets paid for their work and who doesn't. Thank you so much again for coming tonight. And I hope you enjoy tonight's program. And please go upstairs and view the project and the exhibition and grab a packet. And now I present Jessica.
Hi. Hello. All right, where are my slides? That's me. That's me too. Oh, that's my. Can you hear me? Is this on? Yeah. Okay. Hi. I'm excited to be here. I flew in from Toronto. Decided to also make a hot romantic weekend. Hi, Jamie. Jamie is also here and is shy and oh no, I'm gonna get in trouble later, but that's okay. They helped take the photos of me and I appreciate that. That one. It's not a solo project. Okay, so I'm Jessica and basically, everything I do is a collaboration. I'm an artist, an activist, a researcher, a UN delegate, whatever you want to call me, in order for you to be able to listen to me, and I'm that. So it is true, I will be at the HIV/AIDS high-level meeting at the UN later this week, if you knew that was happening. I'm talking to the government people and stuff, but this is also what I do in parallel. I am really interested in ways to make dialogue and have really difficult conversations with people most impacted and trying to have those conversations with people who might not always get it. So I brought up these two slides, one of them being I make banners, activist banners that of obviously merge art and activism with different people. I host them publicly in places. This was at the HIV is Not a Crime training in Alabama, where all this real fucked up shit I was hearing about HIV criminalization laws, especially in the US, where people are getting charged for sneezing. Imagine, sneezing because they're living with HIV, spitting, some like and I don't know, just all that stuff. So anyway, we in this workshop we got together, I brought many of the banners here, and we were able to talk about it. And art's really it creates an amazing space to talk through some of the hard issues. And Ted, who was there, we didn't think it was going to be the smoothest event, as most of them start off. You're like, what issues impact you the most? And people say, like, really privileged stuff and haven't really worked through all those pieces yet. But while collaborating and doing a piece together, they were able to talk through all those really hard stuff. So what also happens with the work I do is it's not just like, okay, we're gonna leave it. It's like, okay, what do we wanna do with it? So these banners in particular are going to be used in protests in South Africa during the AIDS conference, and they're here tonight, many of them, such as Awareness is Shitty by Ted Kerr and friends. And yeah, and they move places, and I think that's really important for us to do things as a community and have them be brought out into the world. So I also make them myself, and most of the time they're used in political protests. The one outside that says HIV is not a crime, AIDS profiteering was actually done in Vancouver because there was an epidemiologist who was making quite a lot of money off researching POS folks. But on the flip side was also testing in criminalization cases against people living with HIV. So me and a number of ladies who participated in another tea time project, we had a tea party, we thought about it, and we stood about 50 of us in the back of his lecture at this very fancy meeting. And from that, he lost all of his contracts. It was very exciting. So what I try to do, I guess next slide, the other piece of my work is, so it's putting these words into action. So I make the banners, but I also, like my whole life, since I've been 20, I've been living with HIV, my whole sexual life pretty much, and there's a lack of representation of super sexy pause ladies. It's mostly around women having and birthing of the children, which I'm also going to experience soon, but that's like 15 years later. but that will still be a sex positive experience because that's also possible. So the PlaySmart series was super important to me because I have been dreaming and asking to be on a PlaySmart card to just show that. And one of the cards I actually did with Jamie was actually showing the desirability. It's not just like, yeah, I look hot. Yeah, sure, I'm like half naked in my bed. Welcome, come. But it was also like, oh, now there's someone touching me and touching me like under my clothes, you know? And I felt like that was really and has been really important for me and through the work I do. So I'm super honored to be on this panel. I'm sure my 5 minutes is up. And I will leave it to you, Joe.
Hello, how you doing? Okay, my name is Egyptt Labeija. This is a trailer about a short movie called Happy Birthday, Marsha. It is a film about the legendary transgender activist and artist, Marsha Pay It No Mind Johnson. And her life in the hours before the 1969 Stonewall riots in New York City. And I had the pleasure of being in this.
In case you didn't get the message, but I can see you did, because you all are the message. We have someone here that's gonna sum it all up for you again. Of this here island. She's the saint of Christopher Street.
It's gonna be legendary.
It's Miss Marsha P. Johnson.
Okay, so that film was long and hard to get together because the simple fact is people that really did not know Marsha were doing the Stonewall riot movies, but they didn't talk about the person who actually started the Stonewall riot. So when they asked me to do it, it was a privilege to me to do it. Like I said, my name is Egyptt Labeija. I am a ballroom queen, a showgirl, as you see, and I am the former coordinator for TransJustice at the Audre Lorde Project. At the Audre Lorde Project, we had a lot of obstacles to go through to make sure that trans women get proper care, proper rights. One of our major campaigns was HRA and discrimination on trans and gender non-conforming people. So it took 9 years back and forth where they kept saying, no, it's not a problem. Finally, they said, yes, there's a problem. So we had to come up with a policy that they had to follow to conform to trans people. And me, and amongst other people, actually had to train HRA how to treat trans and gender non-conforming people. It wasn't easy because some people, how can I put it in a nice way, are just bigots. You know, they don't realize their job is to help you. And if your name is this, you call, if I'm a she, you call me she. Do not call me out of my comfort zone. So finally, that went to play. And we started with HASA, and now we have started training regular HRA to how to treat trans and non-conforming people. I am very honored to be here today with all of these ladies up here. This is an amazing panel. And what we do is not easy work. You know, a lot of people on the outside just think, you know, we just go up and we do this and we say this. It's not easy. Every event that goes on takes months and months of planning. It takes a lot of resources, and it takes people like you to show up. And we appreciate that. And it's not, this is just the beginning. What we do is just the beginning. We all, and I'm so sure some of you out there have a lot of things, bless you. We have a lot of things that we want to do and that we are going to do as far as helping women. Is that my time? Okay, so like I said, you know, I am the former coordinator for TransJustice. I will always be a part of TransJustice. And on Friday, June 24th, is Trans Day of Action. And it is from 3 to 6 in Washington Square Park. Does everyone know where that is? Google it, you'll find it. And thank you so much, my guys. I love you and can't wait to see you.
Hi, I'm Joy. Can you hear me okay? No? How about now? Okay, well, let's see how I'm going to do this. I think I have a lot of things here. So I too wanted to thank LJ and Alex and Visual Aids for inviting me to participate and getting to be here with this group of very inspiring artist activists. It's really cool. The three images I'm going to talk about on the top left is from the political funeral of AIDS activist Tim Bailey, which took place in Washington, D.C. on July 1st, 1993. The Marys, which was an affinity group of ACT UP, the AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power, carried out three political funerals between 1992 and 1993. And these funerals, part of the inspiration was from David Ronarovich's book, Close to the Knives, which has that very famous passage that I I'm not going to be able to completely quote, but it was, every time someone dies from AIDS, I wish that their friends and lovers would drive a car 100 miles an hour and throw their body over the White House fence. And because by this point we had been losing so many people, going to a memorial service just wasn't cutting it. Not that that was a very respectful way to go about things, but it wasn't a way to make the world understand what was really going on. And it was like being in a war zone. So the second funeral, this was for Tim, and he was a menswear designer for Patricia Fields, and he was 35 years old. The top right image is an artwork of mine. It's called Aerial View 3 from 2015, and it's an installation with a thin sheet of plexiglass that rests atop a stack, one of them being a large photogram, raw canvas, styrofoam sheeting, and styrofoam packing blocks. And then the image on the bottom is by Fierce Pussy, the queer art collective that I've been involved with since its beginning in 1991. This project was called For the Record, and it was a printed broadside. It was sponsored by Visual Aids for World Aid Day 2013, and it was installed in printed manner at the bookstore in Chelsea that has now moved. And there were piles of the broadsides in the windows for people to take for free. And For the Record grew out of a piece that Fierce Pussy had done at Y Columns in 2010. The exhibition was called Act Up New York, Activism, Art, and the AIDS Crisis, 1987 to 1993. The title of Fierce Pussy's piece was called Get Up Everybody and Sing. And Fierce Pussy conceived of the piece as a bridge between then and now. So looking at these three images, I'm reminded of a variety of things. How my work is multi-platformed, layered, slow. It considers the social environment and the site. How even after 23 years, I still have difficulty looking at my friend Tim in his coffin. How he wanted to fulfill Tim's wish to have a funeral procession from the Capitol's reflecting pool to the front of the White House, but we never made it out of the parking lot because we, as we drove in, we were surrounded by police and riot gear, the CIA, the FBI, and the park police. But we did make it into the New York Times and the Boston Globe. How the photogram installation, Aerial 3, in this iteration seems to slide in space as if it landed there, like Dorothy's house after a tornado. How so many AIDS activists protected Tim's body that day. How knowing and working with three fierce people, Nancy Brooks Brody, Zoe Leonard, and Carrie Yamaoka, collectively for over 25 years as artists and activists is a gift. When you hit it, it's a shared experience. When you fail, it's a shared experience. And that's in contrast to my solitary studio practice. How I continue to try to push the boundaries between photography and sculpture. How all three images are of a performative nature and in gesture. And certain words came to mind: alchemy, temporality, and transformation. How even in death, Tim wished to transform his body into a political statement about the AIDS crisis in the United States. How desperate the times were and how the public needed to know. How that day felt, like I crossed over, never to return to the way things were before. How in the photograms, I am attempting to recreate the sea and the illusion of distance, using silver gelatin photo paper in constant motion, submerged with underwater with salt and suffocant foam, subject to time, light, and photochemistry, transforming matter into a singular image that might look like the ocean from the sky. How Aerial View 3 is never installed in the same way twice. How my art practice transforms my life and vice versa. How all three images depict a moment in time. How as a witness, I have a responsibility to tell what happened. How if he were alive today, he'd still be living with AIDS. Thanks.
everyone. We're Dyke Action Machine.
We're Dyke Action Machine. and we, as the old people on the panel with Joy, we're going to talk about... Not Joy. I was thinking of 1991. That's why I'm saying old. Yeah. That I guess one of the things that we wanted to talk about as we're here is how Dyke Action Machine, the two of us began, we were in Queer Nation together, and as ostensibly as an organization that was supposed to be for queers, meaning everything, men, women, lesbians, gay men, the lesbians found themselves without a voice. So Dyke Action Machine was born, which was a much larger group. Within a year, Sue and I were making agitprop together, just to give you a sort of quick background on it. Do you want to talk about this?
This is a campaign that was done in 98. Basically, the way we operated is we riffed on what was going on at the time in terms of advertising. And this was the year that Ralph Lauren was really starting to feature red, white, and blue, which which he still does. Hey, if it works, don't fix it. Also, we were taking our cue from WPA posters, and we had this message that the lesbian would be this kind of very earnest authority that could really just tell it how it is. And
not only the lesbian, the butch lesbian, all right?
An important clarification.
The authentic American. just to back up slightly, just to give a context, I mean, one of the reasons that Sue and I became involved with doing activism was because we were sort of swept up in what was going on in the gay community around ACT UP, around Queer Nation. This idea that we as artists, as people who worked in commercial design, could bring all those tools to promote a kind of lesbian visibility, which at the time we didn't fully understand how that would operate. I mean, now it's like, yeah, there's a lesbian on TV, whatever, right? So it's like this idea that visibility itself is going to be this gateway to tolerance and acceptance was a very complicated journey through Dyke Action Machine. And I think it's interesting to see the things that have come out. I mean, in a way, to look at all these banners and stuff here, it's like everything has gone from being very glitzy and sort of advertising oriented to these sort of handmade banners. So we're becoming neo-Luddites, I guess, which could be part of the future. Sue also shot something for the Placemark cards. Do you want to talk about those? Can we have the next slide?
Great. So this is the Placemark card that I shot. LJ got in touch with me, and she had this idea of, of getting this idea that we could make it kind of have a full circle. And once... that idea was put in me, I was like, oh my God, I want to do it. But then I couldn't do it. And then last minute, we decided it was going to be a rainy day. Actually, this was supposed to be like a wet t-shirt kind of thing we were going to do. But we ended up shooting her on a black background. And that's me shooting her there. But bottom line, the idea I liked about this is that Serena is one of the only Asian American in the fire department. You can't, is there another one? No, she's it. She's the only one. You can't get more marginalized than that. And Dyke Action Machine has a history, a rich history of shooting and highlighting the marginalized lesbian, butch lesbian, whatever it is. That was kind of like our specialty. So this idea that that LJ asked me to do this was really quite an honor. And only 51 women in 11,000 firefighters in New York City. Yeah, it's worth gasping about. One Asian American woman in the entire New York City Fire Department. So My idea was to make her look really hot.
Totally succeeded.
It wasn't question. Hard.
I also got to hold the helmet during this shoot, which was possibly one of my favorite. It's like a new part of my artist practice is being able to hold helmets and props during lesbian and dyke pinup shoots. Anytime. I'll drop whatever I'm working on.
You were an awesome assistant. Just going to say that. And producer. And
just to sort of, sorry.
Yeah, come.
Just to contextualize this a little bit more, and maybe for some of the younger people here, the idea behind a lot of this work, including the stuff that Fierce Pussy did, was this notion that we needed to see ourselves in public. And that was not happening at that time. We were not part of mainstream visual culture. We were not being advertised to, if you take that as a mark of being present in American culture. Or maybe it's a good thing, I don't know. So again, this raises all these interesting questions about what would we look like and how would we look in a way that other people who are not queer could recognize us. So that was a very important part of how this thing operated. And if you want to see more, there's another campaign upstairs of the Do You Love the Dyke in Your Life, which was based on the Marky Mark underwear Calvin Klein ad campaign.
It's only covering an enormous wall upstairs.
So you might see it.
Yeah, you might see it as you walk in.
Underneath the banner that says failure is impossible, which is kind of amazing. The suffragist banner. So thank you.
so hard to follow all of that. It's really astounding for me to sit up here because I discovered Dyke Action Machine and Fierce Pussy as a college student, so we're dating myself, circa 2000. And I didn't even want to be an artist when I was an undergrad, and it was really a gateway for me to understanding how art and activism could increase a lot of visibility and could make a really big difference, a tangible difference. So it's astounding to be here with you all, and then with Egypt and Jessica and Kia, I feel like I show up like all of your events because I'm so hungry to see the work that you do all the time. Like, I'm such a total fanboy. But and the Trans March of Action has always been a really important thing in my life and really empowering, and seeing Jessica's banners and going to your events and always seeing Kia dance. And then also, I'm kind of introing you, and you can say no if you don't want to talk about this, but Kia, reading Kia's writing lately on ArtAids America and everything that you've gone through with that was super influential in trying to shape this project.
Thank you.
And it was so eloquent to see how you handled all of that. So I wanted to pose one question, and then we're going to open it up, but to ask you all, how did you come to merge your art with your activism? What was the genesis of that? And how has it evolved in your practices? And where do you plan on taking it in the future? And part of that also goes into, all of you have such diverse practices because, you know, both of you did all of this agitprop, but you're working in really different mediums now. And Kia does photography and dances and also it speaks out in these really beautiful ways. And Egypt is acting and also organizing, and Jessica is throwing, I don't know if you want to call it social practice. We've had talks about that term and our feelings about it. But to talk about the diverse practices and how they merge with your art and activism and how that begun and where it's going.
Maybe I'll start because I didn't say anything. I mean, I said a lot of things. Body language. I really first started kind of making this work when I met Visual Aids, when we started working together, which was kind of happened by chance or by the universe brought us together, because as someone who was born HIV positive and I lost my mom when I was 14, I didn't have like a lot of space and room to talk about it for a very, very, very long time. And then by chance, I met Jessica at one of her maybe social practices or one of her art gatherings in this amazing project called Tea Time, where she brings women living with HIV together to have tea parties, which is so fab and fun. And it was the first time I had met another woman living with HIV since my mom passed. Like, I think at that point it was like 9 years or something crazy like that. And I started my series, my piece that I had up is called 11, which is the most recent piece of my series. And I wanted to create artwork that talks about my own experience living with HIV in a way that I can present it as something beautiful, something how I see my life living with HIV in this kind of fantasy world. So it doesn't have to be so scary. It doesn't have to be sad or limiting in any kind of way. It can be, you know, just, it can be beautiful, you know? And I can be beautiful, inside and out. Because what's inside of me is not a biological weapon. Hello. So it's been really, really wonderful, and especially with, you know, movement and dance and voguing. You know, voguing is a practice that literally comes from posing in magazines. So the two kind of correlate very, very well together, and I think of myself in my self-portraits as dancing, as voguing, as posing, you know, for myself, because I take the pictures myself. But yeah, it's been a really amazing experience to share that with everybody.
Do we want to move this way, or just whatever?
Jump in, y'all.
Yeah, jump in.
All right, well, I'll go.
I came to activism because I graduated from art school as a painter and was completely freaked out by the art world and didn't think I would have a place there, and was also living in the middle of the AIDS crisis and also coming out. I mean, I was out in high school, but I wasn't an activist, or I didn't have a community. So just sort of getting my sea legs in terms of being part of lesbian and gay culture. And so that was basically what drew me to go to ACT UP actions and Lesbian Avengers and a lot of the things that came out of that Irish lesbian and gay organization that protested the St. Patrick's Day parade for many years. So to me, that became this sort of location for my art energy. And I was really interested in people like Barbara Kruger and Jenny Holzer, who were very important at the time in terms of combining text, and I was earning my living making graphic design. And so there was a kind of synergy with all of this stuff. And then Sue and I sort of collaborated for how many, 18 years?
Wow.
Something very long. We started in 1991, and our last thing was in 2008, 17 years. And we still do things occasionally together. But I since have become mostly a painter, and I write a lot, and I feel like my activist energy goes into teaching now. I teach at Hunter, and I'm just really interested in creating a space for students who want to be artists but who are not very entitled. So in whatever way that means, class, gender, race. I feel like that's really this heart of where all that energy has gone that's not in my painting. So, yeah.
I think I got involved in activism because I've always sort of been interested in this idea, and me and Carrie have sort of argued over this idea over the years about, can you be ironic and also be radical? And in the 90s, I would say yes. we could be ironic, and it was really radical to like have this idea of that we were like these lesbian consumers in advertising, and that we were the lesbian advertising agency. That seemed very ironic and radical. Now, how many, I don't know, lesbian advertising agencies are there? I mean, who isn't?
I know,
right?
Of one in Brooklyn.
So I think that is really kind of the genesis of where I was coming from. I really was interested in this idea of irony, of taking this, what we basically do is culture jamming, taking this corporate space, or this space that's normally occupied by corporate media, and inserting an ironic / political activist message. Now I feel like there are other ways to be radical that are a lot more powerful. I don't know how many radical things I'm doing right now. Sometimes I feel like just indoctrinating young people in some way. I think that can be powerful. Sometimes I just have to say like things like money can't buy you love, and I feel like that is radical. I work in construction management right now, so I feel like that's a really powerful thing to say. But definitely my early years are definitely influenced by this idea, this kind of like ideal view of irony and being radical.
Well, I kind of can't remember the moment that I wasn't somehow feeling like the odd person out and trying to find like-minded people. I was involved with anti-war stuff and abortion rights and anti-nuclear stuff and the gay ballot that was in California. I was there when Harvey Milk was shot. I don't know, just seemed like part of my DNA in a way. And then when I found, my father had died actually, and this is like 89, and my dad taught me a lot about people, and just, he was a very giving kind of person, and I think he made me understand what it is to be human. So when I found this person, I was I had a magazine job doing paste-up mechanical at El Decor magazine. It was right after my dad died. I lost my job, and I was coming back into the workforce again. And I met this guy, Jim Baggett, and I'd go in his cubicle and we'd smoke cigarettes together because these crazy French guys ran El Decor at the time, and they liked to, they were real sadistic. They liked to keep us there to 2-3 o'clock in the morning to move something on the board by a point. You know, really crazy stuff. So James and I would hang out, and you know, we got to talking, we got friendly, and I'd always look around his cubicle and he'd have all these stickers up that said silence equals death and ACT UP. And so I started asking him about it. And he said, oh, you know, I'm gonna take you to a meeting. And at that point, ACT UP had now moved from the center, and it was a meeting at the Great Hall at Cooper Union. And he belonged to this, so within ACT UP, there were smaller groups, affinity groups, and the group that James was a member of was the Marys. And so he brought me into this humongous auditorium with tons of people, like the size of this, but maybe three times the size of this, and that many people was huge. And I thought it was like this wild beehive of people. And I sat down with the Marys, and that was it. I felt like I'd found my family. And it all just made sense to me. And so it just started there. And this group of people, the thing about your affinity group was that you knew that you had each other's backs. And that was a very, that was like family in a way, I suppose. And so it kept the whole thing real in a lot of ways. And the thing that happened simultaneously is that a number of women that I'd met in ACT UP, as we were working in the trenches, we decided that we wanted to talk about lesbian visibility. And so a number of us met at someone's house, and it was really low tech. We had no money. And the first thing we did was we made these lists of every single word that a lesbian was called that was sort of derogatory. And it would say, I am a, you know, muff diver, Amazon, lesbian, feminist, you know, queer pervert, and proud. And we had three of these, and they were like on the typewriter. So Carrie Yamaoka, who's here, we worked both at Condé Nast, and so actually Condé Nast paid for much of Fierce Pussies. Yeah. Fierce Pussy and ACT UP's posters, because we'd stay late after work and run everything off. And that's how we, you know, that was where it all came from. So anyway, long story short, we would blow up these little, you know, tiny things a number of times on the Xerox machine, and we'd get to 11 by 17. And then we'd call another meeting to go out and we'd paste, and you'd have like somebody who'd watch the street, and then you'd wheat paste up on the street. And then you could do it in those days because it wasn't illegal yet until Giuliani came in, and that changed the, you know, the landscape. And then the next project we did was our baby pictures. And that was pretty much something. So you had these very sweet children, which was us at that time. One was Jean Carla Musto, which might be someone that a lot of people know. It was her in this little dress that had little cherries on it, and it said, Dyke. And those were all also wheat paste on the street. We got a lot of responses from that. And so, you know, we do the Lower East Side, we go up on the Upper East Side, you know, whatever. And so all that stuff, you used a word before, parallel. And I think that's really accurate. That's how I feel as well, is that a lot of things are running in parallel. And it's very hard to decide that, you know, this is this and this is this. Cubbyholing doesn't work for me. I think a lot of what I've done over the years has influenced my artwork. It all plays back and forth. It's all happening at the same time. And I have to say that in those really dark years of, you know, late 80s and early 90s, when it was just unimaginable. I think Maxine Wolf, who was a member of ACT UP, I think she counted that we did something like, I don't know, 500 demonstrations in 1 year. So you figure out the math as to how that might have played out. And so you were doing that. You know, you were going to a demonstration, you were going to an ACT UP meeting, we were going to a Fierce Pussy meeting, we were going out wheat pasting, maybe I was in my studio. Then you started visiting somebody in the hospital and you were taking care of them, and I see Maxine Wolf right there. And so, you know, that's kind of how it played along.
That's amazing. I love the... I feel like all of us know someone or have done this thing where we, like, the analog copy machine made a huge, like, I'm dying to get my hands on a copy machine and, like, to have that. It's really a great tool. That,
well, there is something you can use, which is at Kinko's, because Fierce Pussy has used it recently. We did a project called Gutter that we started actually at the Lesbian Her Story Archives. And it's a big planner machine, like people do their architectural plans on it, black and white. Mm-hmm. So it can blow it up and you can kind of do some things that are not dissimilar to that.
Hi again, how you doing? Okay, let's see, my thing actually started 7 years ago in 2009 when I became a student. I was a student at the first TransJustice community school. And this school taught me that to think outside the box. And think outside the box, to me, meant the system is set up to keep you in this circle so you can't do what you need to do for you and your comrades. The school taught me to say, I'm finding a crack somewhere and I'm getting out. It taught me to have a voice. It taught me to be strong. It taught me to know that I can make a difference in my life, in someone else's life. And when I started realizing that I could actually make a difference, it became contagious. Because when you see that you can say something to help somebody because you're in that situation or you know someone in that situation and you know how to get them out of it. I always tell anybody, it's that thing that they have in the subway. If you see something, say something. It's the same in everyday life. If someone is treating you wrong or someone wrong, speak up, say something, because that can actually help them even save their lives. I got so involved in helping people. Even when I resigned from the Audre Lorde Project, I had people go call me and tell me, my caseworker won't change my name. My caseworker won't change my gender marker. So what I do is, because I'm that kind of girl, I would say, when is your next appointment? I'm going with you. So, because I know the policy, I make sure I have a copy so I can give it to the worker just in case they didn't read it. And I would go in and they would say, well, who are you? Well, this is my client right now, and you are not doing your job. Here is the policy, read it. And we just didn't have anything to discuss. Well, I don't know if I can do it. So the next best thing is, I don't want to talk to you anymore. I want your supervisor. People do not like when you say, I want to speak to your supervisor. Because now they have to deal with the stuff after it's all over with. So long story short is, today I still go with people to their centers to get their name and their gender marker changed, which shouldn't make any sense. But if you call me, I'll be there.
It's funny how when you're just listening, you totally forget the question because I'm so engulfed in everything. So I mean, art, activism. So I think that I made this really cool promise to myself when I was diagnosed, because it was around New Year's. Very fun Christmas, as you can imagine. So I was waiting all Christmas. And then so it was New Year's. So a promise I had made to myself was, anything I want to do in life, I'm going to do it. And I really held that true. Sometimes, like, if I'm going to make some wild decision to, like, not get on a plane and stay for a romance somewhere else, I'll just close my eyes and I'm like, anything I want to do in my life, I'm going to do it. I'm like, I'm not getting on the plane. And it's very dramatic and lovely. But I think that I identified first as being an activist, and working with artists and in the arts community. It wasn't actually till Visual Aids was basically like, you're doing art. And I'm like, well, no, it's just like stuff I make. And they're like, that's art. And your parties are social practice, and that's art. And you curate things, and you're part of that community too. And I was like, oh, I'm shy to use such words. Because let's face it, art community, not nice. Judgy. Activists aren't so nice either, so it's fine. You say what? You know. Anyway, yeah, I think when it came to representation, as I was talking about before, and that we've also heard, is that, like, it sucked being, like, 20. I wanted to be a sex educator, and I was like, how can I be a sex educator if I don't even have sex? And so I was like, my whole thing is, like, okay, well, I gotta, like, make this world for myself, because I didn't see it. And identifying as a queer woman, the queer community, lesbian community, was not so welcoming to pos women. Not saying all, but I didn't find it. I didn't see it. Like, I didn't feel safe to go to the bathhouse and play like everyone else did. I don't know, those spaces, like, someone's like, oh, come to this, like, play party. I'm like, are you joking me? Scary. But then I'm just, like, kind of now, part of my practice is, like, carving out that space and being able to be there and be present. And whether it's, like, having dance parties in my underwear, I want to create that world that I didn't see. And it's been successful, but it doesn't mean that it's not hard at the same time. And I think that this is something that I've been thinking about lots, and sorry if I'm going on a slight tangent, but I think it's really important, I think you said it, about how hard the work can be. And it's actually super, super lonely too. Being the, not the front person, but putting yourself out there all the time is, it may seem kind of easy. It totally sucks. And actually, we've seen in our communities a lot of people that very much struggle with mental health and stuff. And one thing that I've been thinking about a lot lately is that, like, everyone that I've ever known that died of AIDS has been suicide. And that's a very different reality than previously. And I think that's something that we need to, like, talk about. I think about my own mental health a lot, and that of my friends and people who especially have been activists and, you know, getting yelled back at all the time. It's hard to take. So I'm excited to hear all of your questions that you're going to ask us. And I'll just leave that for you to think about.
We want to open the floor.
We have mics in the audience for folks who have questions. We have about 8 minutes for questions, so we'll take a few.
Oh, yeah, take six.
If you could step to the aisle if you're going to ask a question.
Hi, everyone. I was just wondering, there you are on the stage. What role do you think art has to carve out new realities and kind of create spaces where being positive or being queer are looked at in really different ways? How does art do that?
I'll just talk about a project that Fierce Pussy just did. It's in art form right now, but it has no attribute as being from us. And it's actually a transmission from the future to 2016. So we're gonna try and get it out there in different ways because that's just not the best way, but it's one way. And what I think is really interesting about it is that we've been talking a lot about how there's a lot of things that are very negative right now. What if one could think about things for how you really want it to be? And that was the rubric you were looking through as a way to address people. And that's basically how this, you know, this piece is about. But I think that's somehow in the mix, you know. And you use everything you have, right, at your disposal, that you know how to do, to make that happen. And so I think that might—I don't know if that answers your question, but that's what comes to my mind.
I think one thing that art does is that it creates community. First, it creates visibility because. You know, we, as human beings, the way we process things is through what we see, you know, imagery, you know. And in making visibility for yourself, you can carve spaces. Like, because Jessica carved a space and because she was visible to me and I could see her and she could see me, she invited me into her community and I was able to create more community amongst myself. And that is, you know, one of the things that I treasure so much about, you know, our personal relationship is that she actually had already been building the space because she made that promise to herself, you know? And I made a promise to myself too that I would find it, you know? And by chance, the universe brought it to me. So, and I, you know, through my own artistic practice and being so visible myself, I've been able to draw more people to me, and all of a sudden now I have this community. I mean, look at all the amazing people that I'm sitting with right now talking to you about something that before was very, very secretive and kind of silenced and not really, you know, not really talked about. So I think that is really the biggest way in my mind that art can create this kind of community and carving out spaces for each other.
I just want to challenge you on the question, actually, because I feel that the art world is a place that actually fetishizes gay people, queer people. And so it's not, I mean, as somebody who's been around this for a really long time, I feel like because it's called art, it's this place where anybody can say what they want and it's protected and it basically has no impact in a way on the outer world because it's art. So to me, the real challenge is changing that dynamic. So, I mean, I feel like I'm very happy to be an artist. I'm happy that I did activist art, but I feel like we're in a much different moment now in terms of where we're at, where younger people are in terms of their own identity. It's like we came up, we didn't have the support as young people. I mean, and they're not to say that everybody has it, but the terms are really, really different now. And there are a lot of older gay artists who are supporting and mentoring younger artists, so it's a really different world, and I really encourage people to rethink this as a location to just describe your own personal identity and find a community. I feel like it needs to be bigger than that. That's, sorry, I'm being the Debbie Downer right now, but.
How do we do that?
I think it's, I mean, to me, it's as much about class and all this other stuff that's going on in this country. I feel like art, the art world is this very privileged location. And yeah, I don't have any answer. I just feel like having watched how identity has operated in the art world for 25 years, you know, I mean, it's, yeah, I'm not going to dig myself any deeper, but.
I wanted to take Jessica's bait about thinking about mental illness and what it looks like to die from AIDS-related complications now. It made me think of the Grand Fury piece that's up in the Agitprop exhibition, Women Don't Get HIV, They Just Die From It, that was born of women's HIV-related symptoms not being classified in the like AIDS diagnosis list, and there was like a movement to get women's symptoms considered part of an AIDS, like categorized as something that could qualify for an AIDS diagnosis and get them access to services, treatment, medication. So I guess my question back is just, what does it look like what do we need to add to the list of like what it looks like to live with HIV, struggle with HIV now, like what is not being, like what is part of the experience of women or people living with HIV now that's not seen as part of the struggle?
Okay, let me think. There's a long list. I don't know. It's challenging. I think about all the women I know. I'm trying to keep it more in like a local context because I do lots of global work. I actually work for the International Community of Women Living with HIV in the global office. So I work a lot in Eastern Europe and Central Asia, the Caribbean, as well as the with young women and girls all around the world. So, but I think, and it's very different in different places and spaces. Like for instance, PrEP, that is not a conversation that happens in other places. That is really part of a conversation that happens here with certain people. It takes up a lot of space, but its impact is tiny. But when it comes to side effects, where are you? Hi. when it comes to side effects, I hear the way that especially women's bodies are treated is really different. So if there's a lot of weight gain, then it's like, well, you just need to do a sit-up. That's not a side effect. Some hair loss, you know, or fat redistribution still happens in a lot of women's bodies, but it's blamed a lot of times on women for being a deficiency in them. As if you gained 40 pounds, as my friend did in 2 months, that's from not doing enough sit-ups. So I think that's something that needs to be talked about. And a lot of women I know, they've actually don't take their medication, they don't want to, and they're also the same women that do adherence workshops and our leaders in the community talking about, come on, take your meds every day, guys. You can do it. Which, once again, when talking about activists in the movement, that's the double life some of us lead, myself included. I think another issue that's not talked about is around reproductive rights, forced and coerced sterilization, especially globally of those are able to bear children. It's a thing that happens, and there are very active court cases that are happening now. Namibia, Kenya, I didn't keep it local, Thailand, and so on. And these are also, there have been cases of more domestic that people don't talk about, especially doctors telling people not to do it. And around breastfeeding, people can be, babies taken away, locked up, even if there's like no transmission. The power dynamics that exist, especially in the gender disparities around HIV criminalization more broadly, are really scary. Condom negotiation, if condoms are used, it's not so easy when you're gonna fuck someone to be like, hey, can you put on a condom? It's actually not your decision if you're sleeping with someone who, that would be one of the tools. Anything else?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of things that we don't talk about, especially, you know, women's mental health in terms of living with HIV and especially side effects, because, you know, as women, we already face a lot being in the world, and we are already criticized so much and have been criticized and will be criticized so much about how we look, how we dress, what we think, and all these different types of things. And then when you add something like HIV to it, which, you know, can make you feel unpretty, you know, because the society tells you that, okay, there are all these modes of transmission in which, you know, someone becomes HIV positive that, you know, are like very, what's the word? I'm looking for a word.
Undesired?
Someone give me a word. That are like dirty or nasty or stigmatized.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's a better word for that. But you know what I'm saying? Like, people are like, oh, you got it because you were using dirty needles, or you were being promiscuous, or, you know, all these kinds of things. Shameful. And even the kind of language that we use, you know, people are afraid to get tested because of things like, you know, someone coming in being like, oh, well, you know, you're clean or you're dirty, you know, all these kinds of words. And, you know, side effects are incredibly, incredibly harsh on women's bodies, particularly. You know, we don't talk about, you know, everything that comes with taking very violent medications every single day, you know, what that looks like, what that feels like. There was something else I wanted to say.
And how hard it is to take it every day.
It's very, very, very hard
to
take it every single day. You know, I went to go do jury duty. It was awful. I went to go serve jury duty, and they were like, you know, if you don't think you can serve, you can, you know, you can go and you can leave. So I went to the office, and I was like, I'm very nauseous right now. I need to leave because it's 9 a.m. It's very hard for me to get up in the morning because I take my medication at night. So it's very hard for me to get up in the morning without feeling dizzy and tired and nauseous and all these things. And I went to my doctor, and I was like, can you write me a note for jury duty? And she was like, no problem. She was like, I'm gonna write like a really serious note so that they never, ever call you again. Is that okay? And I was like, yeah, tell them everything. Tell them that, you know, I have like diarrhea, and that I like, you know, I'm vomiting all the time. Like, do whatever you have to do that. But in the letter, I read the very end, and it says that, you know, Kia will have to take this medication for the rest of her life. And that kind of hit me really hard when I read it. I was like, oh my God, you're right. I've been taking this for my entire life, and until they present us with the cure, because I'm sure they already got it somewhere locked up. You know, this is what life looks like for us, you know, and there's not enough conversation, there's not enough visibility, and there's, you know, there's not enough awareness of the things that we go through as women. And another thing is violence. You know, violence is a big part of it too. You know, a lot of women become HIV positive because of domestic violence, because of, you know, their partners, because of rapes, all these kind of things that we don't talk about because we're so scared or it's so shameful or stigmatized. So that's why things like this are very, very important. You know, conversations like this that we're having in these kind of very big spaces, institutions, are so important because, you know, we can finally be together, which is not very often because we don't get as much funding and we don't get as much, you know, platforms, you know, to actually be together and talk about what's important and what we need to see change.
So that's our event. Thank you all so much for coming. And let's give one more round of applause for the fantastic folks. Thank you to the Brooklyn Museum for having us. Please grab PlaySmart cards on your way out. Check out Agitprop on the fourth floor. And hope to see you again soon.
Can I make an announcement? So there's a couple of events that are happening this week. On Monday at Cooper Union, there's a screening and discussion on the film called Consent. It's about sexual assault law being used in HIV non-disclosure cases and how that impacts women. It's a very, very interesting conversation around feminism and HIV. So please come. It's from 6 till 9. Yeah, come to that one. Cooper Union, Monday night. And there'll be snacks.